right, here we go, everybody. It is week seven. Yes, week seven already in the National Football League as we get you ready for another exciting weekend of NFL action. Got some pretty good matchups on the slate here for week number seven. And yes, we are running a little shorthanded today, but nevertheless, we're still going to put together a great show for you guys. I got Paul and Nick here. And guys, 94 games, will be 94 games after the Thursday night game heading into the football Sunday slate. I think if there's anything we learned from last week, we can't figure this league out. I mean, we had the last two undefeateds of the year, both fall on Sunday. And as we enter this week, it's the first time since 2017 that no team will start the season at 6-0. Although the 49ers, the Chiefs, the Dolphins, the Eagles, and the Lions do shit the league's best record at 5-1. So you guys ready to do this thing for another big weekend of games?
Yeah, let's go.
Let's do it.
All right, absolutely. And just running through the standings here real quick. So Nick DiMartino is still in the lead here with 127 points. Now, Zan, I was able to get his picks from what he did with us, too. He's got 124 after I calculated it through. Ben Kruse, Tom has 119. Ben has 115. So do I. And then Nick, Hank, and Paul all have 110. But I'll tell you right now, if there's anything we've learned, 1 week changes this. I know Nick's trying to get back on a winning way. I know he's been a little bit on a poker term here on tilt following two rough weeks. But you know, Nick,
Wait a minute. Am I on tilt because of poker or am I on tilt because two of the favorites completely blew themselves up in week six?
Yes. But in real life, though, I think you should be happy because your Jets had a big win against the Eagles and now enter their bye week at 3-3. I think that's what you wanted to get to the bye week at 3-3, right?
Can I give a hot take though first before we get into this game? Yeah, I don't think the Jets defense won that game.
I think it kept them in it though.
I think Jalen Hurts threw three terrible interceptions. Three. And completely the defense didn't do anything. He made three really bad throws and it cost them the game.
But it did also hold the Eagles to a very low score, though, at the same time. Right. I think you're not giving your defense enough credit, though, Nick. I mean, if you think about it, I mean, they kept Paul's Chiefs in check. They had a chance in that game. The defense has been – I mean, the only game they really struggled with this year was the Cowboy game, really, if you look at it.
The one thing I will say, though, is that Patrick Mahomes definitely played down to the Jets a ton in that game.
He definitely did, but you got to give a lot of credit to the secondary, though, too, because the secondary had guys locked up. Kelsey was not free the entire game.
I'll give you that. Kelsey's looked bad all year, in my opinion, so far.
He's had a couple of good games, but he's been locked up. That's just the way that the offense is going, though, right now. They know that there's no receiver that they really trust, so they're double, triple teaming Kelsey's and kind of forcing their hand a little bit.
I mean, are we going to start talking about the Taylor Swift curse with Kelsey, like a Kardashian curse?
I don't think it is.
No, remember he was hurt at the start of the year. Maybe he's still trying to work his way back from that.
But
yeah, and he had like 10 catches for like 130 last week, I think, for against the Broncos. I mean, I know it's the Broncos, but
not a big game. I'd be scared for Philly right now because Philly looks a little lost as a team. That's what I'm willing to say right now, and that. So. That's might be one of my potential upsets. Just saying.
Stay tuned. That's the game of the week here in week number seven. But we'll see what happens, and we'll see what happens with Knicks Jets coming off the bye week next week. They play the Giants, and I think that's a very favorable matchup for them. But let's do this thing, guys, here for week seven in the National Football League. Nick Morgasen, it's a Kevin Burkhardt, Greg Olsen, Aaron Andrews, and Tom Rinaldi special on the NFL and Fox. We start with them. As we go to Baltimore, as the 5-1 Detroit Lions take on Lamar Jackson and the Baltimore Ravens, and the Ravens back from London, a 3-point home favorite in this one.
Yeah, I was saying to you guys before we started, I think this line is backwards. I think the Lions should be the 3-point favorite. The Lions are probably one of the better teams right now in their conference. And I know that might be a bold or a hot take, however you want to put it, but they've been playing really good football. Jared Goff has actually played really good football. Now, I know they've had some injuries with Amon St. Brown, and that's going to affect them, but I know they got Jamal Williams back on the running back side. So after the gambling suspension, and Ravens' offense is in free fall right now. Their defense is top notch, but their offense is just not clicking on any cylinders right now. They had that terrible loss in Pittsburgh terrible loss on that game-winning drive. And I just think this is right off the bat, upset City, Lions, +3.
I completely agree with that. I'm taking Lions +3. The Ravens have not been playing good football. Like, I don't care what any line says. Just from the eye test, you can see it. They're, especially on the offensive end, they're completely out of sync on offense. I completely agree with Nick. Last week, they showed almost nothing. Lamar Jackson couldn't really get anything going, especially in the passing game. If Mark Andrews isn't open, nobody's open. They have not been able to do very much. And the Lions have been red hot. I mean, Jared Goff's got 11 touchdowns and 3 interceptions. He's thrown for over 1,600 yards. David Montgomery's had a tremendous year in the backfield. That's just their offense, too. Their defense has been very solid. I mean, Aiden Hutchinson's turning into a star. I love what the Lions have been doing. And the NFC is also very, very wide open. I think you have the 49ers at the top, and you have the Eagles at the top, too. But besides that, everything else is kind of like a question mark. And also, you know, are the Eagles – after last week, you have to start asking the question, are the Eagles legit? Are the 49ers legit if they have a few injuries? Like, you saw McCaffrey and Samuel go down. Are they the same team if one of those guys goes down maybe for the season? I'm not too sure. But, yeah, Lions +3 for sure.
All right, there's two. And the Lions are looking to start 6-1 for the first time since 1957.
Wow.
Versus Lamar Jackson, who right now in his career against NFC opponents is 15-1.
Wow.
You know, right off the bat, this is a tough one because there's definitely a lot to be excited about with the Lions guys. Jared Goff is playing like an MVP candidate so far this year, but I think this is going to be a little bit different because Baltimore is a different kind of opponent with an electric quarterback who is capable of taking over games in a multitude of ways. And we talk about the Lions defense. We also have to talk about the Ravens defense here. They rank in the top 5 in scoring and in total yards. I'm wondering if the Lions defense the defensive front can keep Lamar Jackson off balance and force him into errors. Now, David Montgomery, I believe, is out for this game. And if that's the case, Jahmyr Gibbs will probably have to take the bulk of the carries. It looks like he's going to be back. And the other thing, though, too, is, and I'm not trying to poo-poo the Lions here, but this is going to be the toughest opponent that they've seen in over a month. And last week I went against them. I was a little bold there. This is not going to be as bold, though. I am going to take the money and lay the 3 points with the Ravens at home. I know they're coming back from London, maybe a little bit rusty, but I don't think they're going to put up that kind of crappy performance they did. Look, I said that with London, with the Jaguars coming back to the States, and they put up 31 last week. I'm going to take the money with the Ravens again. No hook. But I'm going to do it. I'm going to take the Ravens here, guys. So laying the 3 in game 1 on Sunday. There you go. Money all aboard. Now, the bulk of our guys are going to agree with you two. Tom has the Lions. Hank has the Lions. Nick DiMartino has the Lions. Ben Kruse has the Lions. Zan's taking the Ravens, but not to cover. So he thinks like a 2-point game with the Ravens, a very close one in this one. So the majority of us are actually going to go with an upset special in game 1.
I just want to point out one other thing as well. Lamar has not done a good job of escaping the pocket. Also, I've noticed that quite a bit the last couple games. Like, usually when he's on his game and the pocket starts to collapse, he can take off and run for 15, 20 yards, and that like opens up the Ravens' drive. He's been getting hit quite a bit when the pocket collapses, and that's not normal Lamar by any means.
Yeah, no, that's fair. I still think Lamar's playing very, very well this year. And if he goes, the team goes. And this is going to be a very exciting one right off the bat here on Sunday. Paul, it is the Kevin Kugler, the Sanchez, Mark Sanchez, and the great Laura Oakman on the NFL on Fox as the Las Vegas Raiders go to Chicago to take on the Bears. It's going to be a battle of backups with no Jimmy Garoppolo and no Justin Fields there in Chicago. And the Raiders, a 2.5-point road favorite here.
God, this is such a tough game because you really have no idea what's going to happen with two backups going. I'm probably going to go. I'm going to take the Raiders at -2.5, mainly just because of the weapons that they have and the fact that you still have Devontae Adams and you still have Josh Jacobs in the backfield. And even though they have an injured quarterback, I think O'Connell is going to be starting for them. And yeah, I mean, the Bears haven't been able to win with Justin Fields. I don't think that they're going to be able to win without him. So I'll go with the Raiders on this one. I don't like it. I don't have Hank here to join me in calling them poverty, though.
Both teams are poverty, I would say, at this point.
Exactly, and I can't call them poverty if I'm taking them this week anyway. So I will take them, though.
It's a very slight take the money.
Exactly. I mean, honestly, I could easily go the other way. I'm not strongly on either side.
This is a game where basically you say, all right, unless you're a degenerate gambler and you feel the urge to gamble on a game, you just don't touch this one. I think Johnny, I almost called you Hank. We talked about the over-under in this game. Like, if you're going to bet something on this game,
the
total would probably be the better option in this game than taking the spread.
Nick, you're 100% right. That's what I was going to say.
So I want to look it up.
37.5, but you can double check that and make sure.
Yeah, I'm looking as in scrolling and looking. I don't see
the game. It's a very low over under.
Oh, I found it. It's 37.5 over under. I would say under, obviously, because this is the battle of two backup quarterbacks, and I was actually going to do this too, but it's going to be a wild, wild circus of fumbles and interceptions and which defense can stay off the field. Again, you have injury to Justin Fields. We don't know how long he's going to be out for. He's got the ligament injury, which is like almost like the elbow injury for a first baseman, like in baseball. Like, you don't know when they're going to come back. That reminded me of like the Mark Teixeira injury with the Yankees, and when he was out for like 8 to 10 weeks. This is bad. The Raiders have a situation of their own too, because I'm sure you guys saw the reports of Davante Adams not being happy with his situation and I don't blame him. They're not using him. They're paying him a lot of money and they're not using him.
He's 100% right.
I don't blame him, but you make the bed, you have to lay in it too. You know,
I mean, he took the money, no pun intended.
And through the fit when he wasn't sure if Rodgers was going to retire, all that kind of stuff. So so I don't know. I mean, going to the Raiders was never a great option.
Yeah, I mean, this is a crapshoot if there was not any other type of game. The Bears, like, they've shown that they can win at home, though. That's the weird resiliency here. Didn't they beat Washington at home?
Yeah, destroyed Washington at home.
That was in Washington.
Oh, was that in Washington?
Yeah, that was 2 Thursdays ago in D.C.
So they're winning road games, which makes no sense. So the Raiders are in a tough situation because, again, Garoppolo out with the back injury. And they pretty much take him by ambulance? That's how bad his back was hurting?
Yeah, it was pretty scary, yeah.
I don't know. Like, I'm still thinking, this is one of those games where, like, I'm still like playing it around in my head because I don't know which way to go. You know what? I can't take the Bears. The Bears have just been a dysfunctional franchise. What is their head coach's name again? Who I keep forgetting.
McDaniel.
McDaniel?
I'm sorry. Josh McDaniels. Yeah.
No. The Bears head coach.
Oh, the Bears. Matt
Eberflus.
Yeah, Eberflus. Eberflus. They keep saying Eberflus is not going to get fired before the season. I think that's a lie, number one. I think he's going to get fired at some point. Yeah, the Bears are dysfunctional. Justin Fields being out makes it worse. In that case, alone, take the money.
There we go. First off, if you're going to watch this game, A, watch it for the broadcast. That would be the only reason. And
or if you're two, a fan.
Or a fan. I mean, yeah, that's fair. Well, I mean, I'm a fan of the broadcast crew, so that's what I'm saying. I'm not a fan.
Well, I meant if you're a Bears or a Raiders fan, I guess.
No, that's fair. You will watch it. I know Zan will. Yeah, guys, actually, I think this is a little bit of an easier pick. Now, the only reason I'm a little hesitant in this one is because I don't know exactly, as we're doing this, who's starting for the Raiders. They haven't announced if it's going to be Brian Hoyer or Aiden O'Connell. But I am taking the Raiders laying the 2.5 here because – their defense is the reason why. First off, this game has like 18-13 written on it. So I would take the under, as you said. They're 3-3 against the spread. The Bears have only covered once. And the Raiders defense, like I said, they've got a defensive player of the year candidate there in Max Crosby. I think he makes a big play in this one. Tyson Bagent for the Bears. I mean, look.
Scrap heap.
Yeah, I mean, do you realize? I had to do some research when he went in. So he was an undrafted rookie who played double A ball, who played Division II football,
which basically is throwaway football, essentially.
Yeah, I mean, it's very rare that somebody that's not in Division I comes in and does it right. I mean, Carson Wentz had some success there, but yeah, I don't think it matters who it is. I think this is 18-13, and I think Max Crosby makes a big play in this one, and I'm going to say the Raiders win against the Bears. And
I could see a few safeties in this game too, to be quite honest. Also,
be that bad. So how about this? How about 16-11?
That'd be great. Hey, it's a cover.
I don't know if that's a score, Gami, but let's just say that as this one. And let's take a look at everybody else here. Tom is going to take the Raiders. Ben Kruse is taking the Raiders. But Hank, Nick D, and Zan are all going to take the Bears plus 2.5 in this one. And in a real close spread, not a crazy play, especially in, like you say, Nick, a crapshoot game here in Chicago.
By the way, not a score, Gami. 2014. Ironically, Jets defeated the Titans 16-11.
Wow. Okay. There we go. So we'll see in Chicago. Spiro Ditas, Adam Archuleta, Aditi Kinkabella on the NFL and CBS. Another potential backup quarterbacks, guys. It's the Cleveland Browns and Indianapolis Colts. Now, Deshaun Watson did return to the practice field on Thursday, so we don't know exactly if it's going to be him or if it's going to be PJ Walker. We do know for the Colts that it is going to be It is
Minshew Mania.
Minshew Mania, and we'll see. And it's going to have to be Minshew Mania for the rest of the season with the news of Anthony Richardson this week. The Browns are a 3-point road favorite. I'm going to go first. And while we talk about the Browns boasting the best defense in the league, I mean, we're talking to, it's legitimately a Super Bowl caliber defense. Their offense, to me, though, is still a major question mark with the uncertainty of Watson, with no Nick Chubb. I mean, it wasn't like their offense lit up the 49ers last week. That was their defense. And the problem, though, for the Colts side is Minshew Mania can't last all year. Jonathan Taylor, they're still trying to get going. Ultimately, again, this is a play where I'm going to ride on defenses. I'm going to lay the 3 with Cleveland here on the road in Indy, Paul.
Oh, so you're taking the favorite.
Okay. I'm going to take the money, yes.
Yeah, I'm honestly going to agree with that. I'm going to go with the Browns at -3. The defense is what it comes down to, just like you said. A battle between backup quarterbacks once again. I mean, most likely Sean Watson not playing and P.J. Walker probably stepping in. But then Gardner Minshew obviously being the Colts quarterback the rest of the season. Yeah, I'm going to go with the Browns. I mean, their defense has been the one shining factor of their season. I mean, they're 3-2 this year so far. And their defense has been one big part of it, I think. So I'm going to go with them over the Colts.
Yeah, I mean, I'm kind of on that front, too. I mean, I think Watson's going to be back. I think he's been out. I think he's going to get healthy and come back. Not that I've documented this for a long time. I'm the biggest hater of Deshaun Watson in every for sure. I got blocked by Deshaun Watson on social media for no reason because he didn't like that I called him out for his negligences on social media. But that's another story for another day. I looked up PJ Walker's stats the other day. 18 for 34, 192 yards and 2 picks. So he didn't have a touchdown in the game. That's number one. So Johnny's point is even made stronger there that the defense won the game for them. But PJ Walker actually didn't look too bad against the Niners, which was kind of shocking. He was able to get the ball down the field on quite a few drives, which the Niners were falling asleep on defense, which made, I don't know what was going on with them last week. I like Minshew, but not for continuous games and all those snaps. Eventually, it's going to come back to bite the Colts. I know they have Jonathan Taylor. That's not enough to win a game. They're going to stack the box knowing that Minshew is in as the starter. I think this is actually an easy cover. I don't even think you're going to sweat this game. The Browns, I underestimated defensively. I thought that was going to be an easy cover for the Niners last week. I really did, and I underestimated. And then I look back at the statistics. They're a top 3 defense, and I didn't even realize it.
They're the best defense in the NFL, Nick.
But I'm saying in general, I didn't know they were a top 3 defense. Like, so yeah, this is an easy cover. Take the Browns.
Yeah, you know, at the end of the day, though, it's still the Browns. But PJ Walker, if he does start, now we don't know exactly. Again, it's another spot where we're doing this. We don't exactly know who's starting as of right now. That it could be Walker or Watson. But P.J. Walker showed that he can play as a backup. He's a very, he's a capable backup. He did it down there in Carolina last year and took them and contributed and took them from the worst record in the league to being relevant to late in the season last year. So he can play, and we'll see what he does if he does play in this one. Hank is also taking the Browns, but the other guys, Tom, Nick D, Ben, and Zan, all taking Indy plus the 3 at home in an upset special against the Browns. Nick, it's an Ian Eagle, Charles Davis, and Evan Washburn special on the NFL and CBS. In the AFC East, we've got Josh Allen, the Buffalo Bills, taking on, well, still looks like it's going to be Mac Jones and the New England Patriots in Foxborough, and the Bills are a 9-point road favorite here.
This is a game I'd like to call a rodeo clown circus. Basically, that's the way I look at this game. The Patriots have been terrible, and Bill Belichick is on the hot seat. And I never thought I'd say those words for the first time in many years. Mac Jones just looks terrible. He looks lost out there at quarterback. They freaking brought in Bailey Zappi after, what was it? They were down 31-0 to the Cowboys, and they finally brought him in and for garbage time duty. The Patriots have nothing on offense. And it's screwing them on defense because their defense is not terrible. It's their offense that is really the struggle. Now, when I look at the other side, you have the Bills' injuries, which were massive. And even though they won last week on Sunday Night Football, that's an embarrassment that it took you a defensive stop on the 1-yard line after pass interference on an untimed down, and you still managed to win the game. But the Giants could have won that game easily after shutting out Buffalo in the first half. So, again, I thought it was going to be an easy win last week. The Bills made you sweat the whole game. And I think Brian Daboll, has every right to be upset about last week's game. It's not his fault either. The Bills better win this game by at least 10 points. So, yeah, I'm going to take them because the Patriots are so bad that I don't think the injuries are going to matter. Now, I know Josh Allen, I think, has the shoulder injury and the elbow injury also. Yeah. But I just think it's not going to matter. Josh Allen will throw for 200-plus yards regardless of the injury. So, take them up.
What about you, Paul? What do you got?
Yeah, I'm going with the Bills at -9, too. I'm surprised it's not even an even higher number, honestly, because the Patriots have been playing that badly. They have nothing going on offense. I mean, it's just a matter of time before Mac Jones ends up getting benched. So the Bills are rolling a little bit. I mean, even if they do have some injuries, I don't think that they're going to have much of an issue at all with taking care of this Patriots team, even if it's in New England. So I'm going Bills -9. It's probably going to be way over 9 points.
It's another opportunity for the Bills to work through what ails them, unless the shoulder injury for Josh Allen is very serious, but he's not saying it is, and it's not looking like it is. But yeah, guys, if Allen was dealing with a little bit more of an issue with the shoulder, I actually could see the Patriots covering this one. But Sean McDermott's 5-1 against Bill Belichick since Tom Brady's departure, which includes 3-0 at Foxborough, and their three most recent meetings were won by double digits. And think about it, this Patriots team is worse than it's ever been before in these matchups. This is a get right game for Buffalo. I think they win this one by at least 10. So I will take the money at Foxborough. And this is a clean sweep for all of us. We're all taking Buffalo -9. But Nick D, Ben Kruse, and Zan are all going to put their bench lock here on Buffalo -9. So once again, a lot of our guys are going big time with a big number against the spread. Hey, listen, I've done 2 double-digit spreads in a row with bench locks. I can't do that this week because there is not one. But I see where they're coming from, including from our Patriots fan, Ben, in that he's taking Buffalo -9 here. I think it's that bad up there that that's what he's going to do. So clean sweep and 3 bench locks for the Bills over the Patriots in Foxborough. It's an Andrew Catalan, Tiki Barber, Matt Ryan, and A.J. Ross special on CBS in the NFC East. It's the Washington Commanders taking on the New York Giants. And the Commanders, a 2.5-point road favorite. I'm going to go first since I'm the Giants fan. These are some ugly numbers to to look at entering week seven. The Commanders have given up an NFL high 34 sacks. The Giants have given up 33. Nobody else has given up more than 25. Now, let's talk about the Giants for a second here. Their defense the last 2 weeks has actually played better, but can they slow down the Commanders? Because the Commanders are putting up 20-plus points per game on average. They've actually put up 20-plus points in almost every game this year. So their offense hasn't been bad. The Giants are averaging 11, and that's where I get to their offense. With Saquon being back there, it looked like he actually had some life. The rest of the team did not. And then, of course, that brings up the fact that the Giants lost another offensive lineman this week to injury in Shane Lemieux. We don't know if it's going to – if, and I don't think it's going to matter if it's going to be Daniel Jones or
Tyrod Taylor
starting there. And also, historically, it seems like the Giants never beat the Commanders at MetLife Stadium.
They don't.
I'm only asking the Commanders as a betting person to win by 3 points. I think they do it. I'm going to take the money with the Commanders over the Giants here, guys. Paul?
Yeah, I'm definitely going to go the same way. I think that the Commanders' dominance in New Jersey has been enough to show you that they're going to keep it going. Giants have had so many issues this year. Their offensive line issues, Daniel Jones probably not even playing. Tyrod Taylor might have to go again. I mean, last week's back and forth with the Bills, I think, is something that you can't bank on happening again. That was just an all-around weird game. And the Commanders have been like a weird team. They're 3-3. Sam Howell hasn't played great, but hasn't played horrible. They've had some production out of some of their offense. Their defense hasn't been amazing, but has shown some glimpses. Chase Young's been doing a little bit of stuff. So that's why I'm going to end up taking the Commanders on this one, because it's a very low number, too, at -2.5. So it's very enticing. If it was a bigger number, if it was like 5.5, maybe 4.5, something like that, I'd probably reconsider it, because I don't think it's going to be a blowout. Yeah. But I'm going to take Commanders at -2.5.
Yeah, I mean, I think we're all preaching to the choir here. I mean, I know Sam Howell's let's put it this way. I think you have the first and the second most sacked quarterback in the NFL playing one another in the same week, which is kind of an incredible feat when you think about that. So how many sacks are we going to see in this game, you think? If you had to take a guess.
Double digits?
On each side?
I don't know about on each side, but total for sure.
And I saw another stat here. The Commanders are 30-56-3 against the Giants on the road.
I would like to know what that number is recently, because it seems like the last few years, the Giants seem to do well down going to FedEx Field versus at MetLife Stadium in between these two.
Right, but who was the quarterback? It was Kirk Cousins for a few games. It was
RG3 probably for a couple.
So
Washington side.
As much as we get on Howell, because he gets sacked a ton, he can make the deep throws. We've seen him do that. Like, his arsenal is deep throw and get sacked. That's pretty much it. The Giants should be ashamed of themselves at the end of both halves, completely blowing two opportunities in the red zone and on the 1 yard line, and Tyrod Taylor calling a run play and not getting back to the line of scrimmage and not downing the ball and not getting at least one more play so you could at least get a field goal out of that. And I think that cost them the game also, because I think if they score there, I think they win.
It's definitely a turner. I mean, it's a 9-point swing somewhat. Yeah.
So, and unfortunately, not that I want this to happen, but Dable's going to get hit for all this. And he shouldn't, but he's going to. So, Commanders are going to win. That's going to make them, what, 1-7, the Giants? I mean,
1-6?
6. 1-6. In my opinion, you got to trade Barkley. You have.
That's something that's going to come up here with the deadline a couple of weeks away. And I think it's now Barkley says that he doesn't want to get traded, but I'll tell you, Nick, I was going to bring this up. I think you've got to look at options here, because you can't bring him back. He's banged up too much. This team is not going anywhere this year. You could get even if you get two mid-round picks for him, I mean, I think you'd sign up for that. Let me just ask everybody this. What's the point in having him on this roster right now?
Nothing.
There is nothing.
They're 1-6. They still have the toughest schedule of anybody in the league the rest of the year.
Yeah. I think they have the Eagles two times at the end of the year alone.
Right.
So even though the Eagles are not playing great right now, but they're still way better than what the Giants roster is.
But yeah. I'll tell you, and those two games might mean something for Philly because they might be playing for the number one seed in the NFC right now, the way things are looking.
I'm trying to look up quickly the Giants schedule just because I want to see.
No, please don't. It's Murderer's Row. I think PFF had it that they
have the
schedule of anybody still because I know they still got to play some teams in the West. It's not pretty. I know they still got to play a lot of the NFC East too.
Yeah, so here we go. So obviously this week, Washington. Then it's New York in week 8.
This is the Jets Super Bowl.
And I don't disagree with you, by the way, because that's gonna be Woody Johnson's favorite game, and then they're not gonna win.
He makes it all about that. That's everything he does is about that.
And to be honest, like the defense is gonna sack them like crazy. That's just my prediction. Like
that is gonna be such an ugly game for a myriad of reasons that.
Then they go on the road for 3 games, Las Vegas, Dallas, and then Washington.
Maybe they get one of them.
So you're going, but you're also going west to east in that trip too, which is not great.
Yeah.
Then they got New England. They should win that game, I would think.
50-50 game right now.
Then it's a bye week. Then they play Green Bay at home on ABC and ESPN, Monday Night Football.
It's a doubleheader that week.
Then they're at New Orleans, at Philadelphia, home for Los Angeles, the Rams, and then Philadelphia again to end the season. That is brutal.
That's 3 or 4 wins.
Yeah.
Probably. If that.
And for Football Friday, right now, I don't think they're favored against any of those teams the rest of the year.
Maybe New England. Maybe.
Is that in Foxborough?
No, it's at home. I can see that being a pick'em. Yes.
Well, it'll be a pick'em. There won't even be a number on it. It'll just say pick'em.
I saw a PK on the Thursday night game before it went up to 1.
Well, see, and they probably didn't. They probably should have had no line on that because we didn't know the status of Lawrence up until game time. But
they can't do that.
This is really bad. And I'll just put this out there. This is not on Brian Daboll. Let's just be fair. And
of course not.
But I just want to say this too. We cannot have this conversation about changing the head coach every 2 years. It just
leads to a dysfunctional mess.
We can't be doing this conversation every 2 years about a new head coach.
You could say the same thing about the Jets too.
Well, yeah, and Sal is there. This is his third year, and you know the conversation is going to come up with him this year because it's his third year. I think it's a little bit different on their side, but I don't know.
You can't blame him for the injury to Aaron.
No, and that's what I'm saying. I mean, the whole offensive line is down. The defensive line is not what it was doing last year. I mean, Kayvon Thibodeau is taking a major step back this year. Just think about this. It's very simple. You can't protect the quarterback, and you can't get to the quarterback. I mean, that's where it starts.
That's the reason I have a problem with in the NFL only when they compare year by year. You can't compare year by year because each team changes. Even if you bring back a lot of the same pieces, you're going to have personnel changes every year. So it's kind of hard to compare. Like, okay, they won 10 games last year. One, they were healthy. They had Daniel Jones. For the most part, they had Saquon Barkley.
Yeah.
This year, how many games has Saquon played?
He's missed at least 3. I know that.
Okay, so his track record is proving himself that he's hurt.
He's missed 23 games in his NFL career.
Okay, you've heard me say this a million times. They shouldn't have signed him. They shouldn't have given in to him and signed. They should have said, "Here's the deal: either you take the contract we give you, or you sit out." That's what they should have done.
But they only gave him $1 million more than.
It was a signing bonus money, so it's not even counted.
But it's not that. Saquon wanted the long-term deal, you know? So if anything, he caved, not the Giants.
And you know what? The Giants were probably laughing at that when he was asking for a long-term deal. Yeah. Like, I can't stay on the field for half a season.
That's why I think right now, if he's healthy and he's showing there, there are teams that'll trade for him. Baltimore.
I think it's going to be like a third and a fifth. Like, if you can get a third and a fifth.
Sign up for that right now.
I think you can get a third and a fifth as long as he can put consistent games together and stay on the field.
By the way, this might be the most amount of time we give the Giants on Football Friday for the rest of the year until we pick the Jets Super Bowl game next week. But yeah, so we're all taking Washington. The only person that is taking the Giants to win this game outright is going to be Hank.
I knew it.
Look, I'm the other Giants fan here. I can't pick them this week.
How can you pick them?
Well, because Sam Howell is the most sacked quarterback in the league this year.
They still have more offensive weapons than the Giants do.
They do have more offensive weapons, and I think they need to get Brian Robinson, I think, a little bit more involved on the running side too. But
I mean, is Curtis Samuel going to like look like Terrell Owens out there against the Giants? Like,
I don't know. I'm joking. We'll see. I'll still be watching this because, you know, at the end of the day, I am a fan, and I do want to see how this defense does too, because that's actually been better the last 2 weeks.
So this time you're going to watch more than the opening number.
Oh yeah, because it's also an afternoon. It's a 1 o'clock kickoff. You know,
that was a joke. That was a joke, obviously. Yes. But
well, I mean, and I have other options too. If this one gets, I mean, I only
to watch baseball.
Options. No, I'll pass. Ouch. But that's what we're going to roll with. Again, when college football is doing better than Major League Baseball's postseason is doing, then you know that there are problems.
Actually, you know what? Give me NBA in a week. Then you'll be able to use that as a competitor of
bad games. Yes, but I have to tell you though also, and you guys know I'm a bigger Knicks fan than anybody else. I'm getting sick and tired of having to look forward to the next sport when sports starts, and that's what's happening. But Hank's the lone wolf. Everybody else taking the Commanders over the Giants at MetLife Stadium. Christopher Myers, Mark Schlereth, Christina Pink special on the NFL on Fox. See, this will be one that I'll be glued into on Sunday. It's an NFC South matchup here as the Atlanta Falcons take on the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. And, Paul, the Bucs at home at Raymond James are laying 2.5.
Yeah, this is another interesting game. You know, this one could go either way, I think. Both teams have been both up and down. You know, I've kind of liked what I've seen from the Falcons this year so far. I mean, Bijan Robinson has been pretty good. Their offense has been decent. I mean, Desmond Ridder has been pretty frustrating, but their defense has looked pretty solid. You know, this is one of those divisional games, too, that could go either way. You never really know exactly which way it's going to go. I'm going to go with the Falcons at +2.5. I'm going to take them winning ultimately and beating Tampa in Tampa. I feel like Tampa started off 3-2. No one kind of expected this kind of a start. I think that the Falcons are going to, take care of business.
Like,
what do you have here, Nick?
I don't know if this is exactly a great game. I mean, I think this is kind of like an average game. I wouldn't say it's a crapshoot like the other games, but it's kind of like a middle of the road game. And I'm not touching the Falcons. I've gotten burned multiple times, trying to take the Falcons. And every time I do, Desmond Ridder throws two or three interceptions and just looks terrible. Not to say that the Buccaneers are playing lights out football by any stretch. You still have to deal with Baker Mayfield, who was on the injury report this past week. I don't even know who their backup is this season. But
Trask, I think, right?
Kyle Trask, that's right. Which is not great. And then I heard these ridiculous rumors about Gronkowski. Did you hear those rumors come out also or no?
Gronk's name's been mentioned to a couple of teams here. But
including the Bucs.
Including the Bucs, yeah, it's not going to happen though. It's just talking points. That's really it.
Yeah, he just needs the attention to be in front of the camera. But yeah, I'm not touching the Falcons. Give me the Bucs.
Yeah, I'm taking Tampa Bay here, laying 2.5, because I look at this and you look at Tampa Bay's two losses this year. They've come to the Eagles and the Lions, two legitimate teams when you look at it. The Falcons, you know, absolute dud against the Commanders last Sunday. I totally botched that one. But give Todd Bowles some credit here because he's got the Bucs playing better than expected to start. You look at Tampa, they have a +6 turnover differential. The Falcons, Desmond Ridder has thrown 6 interceptions, which is tied for the third most in the league. I know they didn't do much on offense last week, but I think this is a spot for Baker Mayfield to outplay Desmond Ridder. So give me the Bucks by at least a field goal at home in this one.
Never thought I'd hear that sentence.
What 2023, man, right? But yeah, it may not be a pretty game on paper, but it's a big divisional matchup here in the NFC South for these two. Paul's going to be the lone wolf, though. Everybody else taking Tampa Bay -2.5. Now, wow. Lone wolves have done well this year in our football picks, so Paul, you might have a shot down here.
Hey, is that a stat that you're keeping track of?
I will look at that. I know recently it's done well. I will double check that and let you know.
I'm curious what the percentage of wins are on that. But
yeah. Well, a lone wolf would mean that they would it would have to be an entirely different. It can't be like a half special, right?
Well, you have to be the only one making that call, whatever you're doing.
So it could be even that, like, let's say somebody took the Falcons +2.5. They think the Bucks would win, but the Falcons take it +2.5 as like a 2-point game. Would that count too as a lone wolf? Because we'd all be taking Tampa Bay to. I guess it would be because they're doing something different than everybody else.
Yeah, right. All right,
I'll get to work on that, folks. I need another vacation. That's what I need so I can work on. I will work on that for the future. Nick, it's an Adam Amin, Daryl Moose Johnston, and Pam Oliver special on Fox at SoFi Stadium. We've got the Pittsburgh Steelers taking on the Los Angeles Rams. And again, another low line. The Rams just a field goal favorite at home here.
I don't know what to think about this game, to be quite honest. Matt Stafford and I don't know. This is a crapshoot game, in my opinion, too. Really, to be honest, like this is pretty much making a pick for a pick. The Steelers, like they won against the Ravens. That was a great come from behind victory. But you have concussion issues and injuries with, I don't know why I always forget his name, quarterback. But why do I always forget the Steelers quarterback?
Kenny Pickett.
Kenny Pickett. I guess because he keeps getting hurt and it's affecting my brain next. I don't like Kenny Pickett. Not a huge fan. How many concussions has he had? Like at least two or three?
I think he had two last year, yeah.
Yeah, I like the Rams. I'm not confident. If you're asking me my confidence level, it's like 50-50, to be quite honest, but I'll lean the field goal at home with the Rams.
So I'll give you a cool matchup to watch here on defense. Aaron Donald and TJ Watt defensively. The latter,
oh, wow.
Watt, who's tied for the league lead with 8 sacks this season. Now, remember though, Watt did get hurt, had like a dislocated finger or something like that he's going to play through for the rest of the season until they said he might need all-season surgery on it. You know, it's weird because here we are, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. We're 8 picks in, and I can't find an upset special here because I'm taking the Rams -3 because I just think there's more pressure on Watt and the Steelers defense to slow down a Rams offense that's trending up with Cooper Kupp and Puka Nacua. And the problem from the side of the offense for the Steelers is they're averaging 12.5 points per game. That's 30th in the NFL this year. And I don't think they're going to be able to keep up with Sean McVay and Matt Stafford. So I'm going to take the Rams at home in this spot, Paul.
Yeah, I'm going to go with the Rams too. I don't think that the Steelers are really going to be able to keep up with them. Steelers have done well so far this season, but the Rams offense has shown that it can be explosive at any time. You got Cooper Kupp back, and Puka Nacua has been amazing this year. Matthew Stafford's kind of been up and down. You know, he hasn't been putting up like ridiculous numbers, but they still have been a very solid team. And in LA too, I like the Rams in this one. It's a very low number too. So I think the Rams would be able to win by a handful.
There we go. So Nick D and Zan also are taking the Rams -3. Tom and Ben are both taking the Rams, but a non-cover. So he thinks that they think that the Rams win by a 2 or maybe even 1. And Hank is going to go upset special, totally taking the Steelers +3 at SoFi Stadium.
I don't get how you take a team in an upset like 3 or under. That just seems like a risk, doesn't it?
Are you talking about the non-cover?
The non-cover, I mean, yes.
Yeah. You would like to get that extra half a point. I'm more comfortable doing that with an extra half a point in this.
But I'm saying 3 or under when you're in pick'em mode, like that's tough to take a non-cover.
It is. Yeah. I mean, It is difficult, but it can be done. That is for sure. But Hank's going the full upset special here with the Steelers +3 against the Rams. Paul, it's a Kenny Albert, Jonathan Vilma, Shannon Spake special on Fox. Also out west, we've got the Arizona Cardinals taking on Geno Smith and the Seattle Seahawks. And this game is getting a hook in one of the larger spreads of the week. The Seahawks at Lumen Stadium, a 7.5-point home favorite.
Yeah, see, this is an interesting game because, I mean, it is a divisional rival. And the Cardinals are 1-5, but they've, as everyone has been able to see, they've been able to play pretty much everybody competitively. So, you know, being -7.5, I think is kind of interesting. But the Seahawks have put together a pretty solid offense this year. Kenneth Walker's had a good season. DK Metcalf's had a really good season. Geno Smith has looked solid again. So it definitely could be done. I'm probably going to take it at Seahawks -7.5. I think that they could definitely win by more than a touchdown, maybe going just over, maybe like 9 or 10 points. But it's the Cardinals. I'm not completely sold on it. I think the Seahawks are going to definitely win this game, but it could be a lot closer than we think. I think the Cardinals have been sneaky throughout the season. James Conner being hurt is a big one, though. They got to split the backfield with Ingram and I forget the other rookie's last name. He's got that long last name.
I saw that.
Oh. Yeah. They're splitting the backfield, and they're both, you know, obviously young, unproven running backs. So that's definitely a big blow. I mean, and Kyler Murray's practicing now all of a sudden. So will he be back in the next few weeks? We'll have to find out. But I'm going to go with Seahawks at -7.5.
Yeah, they did open that 21-day window for him to return. Nick?
Yeah, so like Paul said, Connor's on IR, so he's obviously going to miss 4 games. I'm shocked. Like, even though they're not winning games, like, they're staying in games until, like, after the half in the third quarter, which is really surprising. I mean, not that I want to relive revisionist history for Giant fans, but it took them all the way to the third quarter, like the end of the third quarter, fourth quarter, to secure that victory, which that first half was bizarre by every standard of that game. But the way I look at this game, Seattle's going to be angry after the way they lost last week to Cincinnati. They should have won that game last week versus Cincinnati, the way they were playing that game. Everyone looked at me like I was nuts that I took Seattle. Like, they almost covered that, too, which is kind of nuts.
Yeah.
But I think Geno's going to be mad because his offensive line cost him some throws at the end of the game there. He kept getting sacked. And you kept hearing the front, don't take the sack. Don't take the sack. You're going to kill the clock. And I think he took 3 straight sacks, if I'm not mistaken. So I think Seattle's going to come out angry, and I think they're going to win by 10.
Sometimes timing is, well, maybe not sometimes. A lot of the time in the NFL, timing is everything. Because this is a game that, if this was scheduled a couple of weeks ago, I think I would take the Cardinals getting the 7.5. But
absolutely,
I think the rose has come off the thorn here for Arizona. Their last 3 games, guys, they have been outscored 95-45. But at the same time, look at Seattle. They're not playing their best football right now. And I think this is probably the get-right spot, though, for them. If Geno Smith has another bad game, though, that's what could make things interesting in this one. And I'm kind of tempted because I'm getting that extra half a point to at least take the Cardinals plus the points here. But I think what Seattle needs to do is they need to take the pressure off Geno and pound the rock. You know, last week the Cardinals allowed Kyren Williams to rush for 158 yards. You know, get Kenneth Walker involved here in a big, big way, and I think they control this game. And, you know, the 12th man there in Seattle will make a play here. Kind of tempted, and maybe they're tempting you to take Arizona getting the points. I'm not going to do it, though. I will take Seattle laying the 7.5 at home in this spot. Tom's also going to do that. Ben and Zan will do that. Hank's going to take the points with Arizona. He thinks Seattle wins, but Arizona covers, and the same thing with Nick D as well. So we're all going to be in agreement that Seattle wins, but two of our guys will at least grab the points there with Seattle in this one. All right, we interrupt this this Football Friday for some breaking news. So let's go to it, Nick.
Good evening. I'm Chuck Hardball.
I'm Wendy Slam Jam. Our top story tonight involves a wild incident from the world of sports that has fans everywhere buzzing.
A suspect is on the loose after a brutal beatdown that has left one man severely traumatized.
That's right, Chuck. The police are on the lookout for a man whose identity remains a mystery.
The suspect has been described as great physical prowess, wearing a red jersey with the number 87 on it. He's described as having caught more W's in a short time than the Denver Broncos have had for over a year now.
Police say he was accompanied by a woman with blonde hair and is described as being irresistible. Even NFL Commissioner Roger Goodell is smitten with her.
Police warn that these two are not fearless about making headlines.
We're not sure if they were shaking it off or just trying to begin again, but this dynamic duo sure made a mark on their victim.
Said one eyewitness, I knew it was going to be a tough game, but this was a love story we weren't prepared for. They were trouble when they walked in.
We'll keep you updated on this bizarre story as it unfolds, but we leave you with the only words we could get from the victim.
Broncos country, Broncos country, Broncos country, Broncos country, let's ride.
Oh my God.
Oh, that's fantastic.
That was good.
That was really good.
Oh, you know, it's almost like Russell decided, oh wait, I need to get in, so I'm stepping in right now, and let me say my phrase. Oh my God.
By the way, can we get enough Taylor Swift song references in there? Jeez.
It was too good. You know, but Nick, it's too easy. That's the thing. Her songs are too easy to make into puns. That's the thing. It works out great. That's why if the Jets would have beat them a couple of weeks ago, you could have told Taylor, welcome to New York. All right, let's get to the game, though, itself here, guys. It's a Kevin Harlan, Trent Green, and Melanie Collins special on CBS. As Jordan Love and the Green Bay Packers take on Russell Wilson and the Denver Broncos, and the Packers a 1-point favorite at Empower Field at Mile High. A couple of weeks ago, I thought this would be no contest. Jordan Love had 6 touchdown passes in his first 2 games, but now in his past 3, he's got 6 interceptions. But this week, I think, brings 2 critical factors that should help him get right. He gets to face the Broncos defense, which ranks dead last in scoring defense, total defense, opponent's completion percentage, passing touchdowns allowed, and opponent's passer rating. And second, it appears that Aaron Jones could be back in the action. And again, we know how bad that run defense is. Yeah, I think this is a get right spot for the Green Bay Packers here. I'm going to take the money with them in this one. Paul?
Yeah, I'm definitely going with the Packers. I think at -1/2, that's really interesting. It's basically like a pick'em in this situation. But I think the Packers are definitely going to come away with the win. Jordan Love started off the season very solid. He's been very inconsistent over the past few games. His numbers have kind of skyrocketed. He's up to 8 touchdowns, 6 interceptions, I think, now. But Aaron Jones could be back, which would be huge for the run game. So him and Dylan will be in the backfield. And, you know, I think the Packers have an overall pretty solid team. The Broncos, again, their defense has been the worst in football. So I think the Packers are going to end up coming away with this.
Yeah. I mean, this is a bad game too. Jordan Love has totally burned me again. Another guy who's burned me on the gambling front, especially against the Lions and against the Raiders. I don't know. Jordan Love, like you said, Johnny, looked really good at the beginning of the season with the 6 touchdowns. Then he lost a major game against Detroit, I think at Lambeau, and that was on, what was that, Monday night?
Thursday night.
Yeah, Thursday night. I don't know. Jordan Love is kind of like a roller coaster, like with all the bumps in it. Like you don't know if it's going to stay on the track or if it's going to go off the track. But can you really pick the this line is basically begging you to take the upset with the Broncos. That's what they're begging you to do here. I think that's a trick. We all know that's a trick. Take the Packers -1. But I will say this, though. If Jordan Love throws 2 or 3 picks, I wouldn't be surprised if this went the other way and the Broncos found a way to win this game. But you wouldn't catch anybody taking the Broncos outright to win this game at all.
Except Hank and Zan.
What?
Yes. Hank and Zan both taking Denver. Everybody else, though, is taking Green Bay.
That makes no sense, but okay.
Well, maybe that's more of a play on Green Bay, though.
Well, that's what I said. I said it. I said if he throws two or three picks early and you put them behind the eight ball, which once the Packers fall behind the eight ball, Jordan Love doesn't play catch up very well.
Yeah. No.
So if he throws two picks and you get a pick six, at least one pick six, Jordan Love is going to be playing trail ball the all game and they're going to lose.
Yeah, I just think that it's now or never. I mean, this is the perfect kind of matchup for him to get right against how horrific that Bronco defense is.
I will say right now, if they lose to the Broncos, you're going to have to blow this season up, in my opinion, if they lose to the Broncos.
Green Bay?
For Green Bay.
Well, I don't know. What do you mean by blow it up? Because they don't really have a lot of trade pieces on that team. Because they kind of already have done that.
If Jordan Love can't beat the Broncos, there's going to be a lot of questions in Green Bay.
That's fair. I mean, it's you know, this is kind of a rebuilding. This is a rebuilding year. It's a growing pains kind of year there, though, for Green Bay. So I don't really know what they could do there.
But if you can't beat a dysfunctional Broncos team, you have a lot more questions to answer.
Understand. Yeah. I mean, it's certain. But you know what, though, this league year, I mean, it could happen. I mean, they're only laying a point. You know, that's what they're telling you. They're not. Vegas is not confident in them doing it either, because otherwise they'd be fetching probably 3 to 3.5. But the way they've played the last couple of weeks too, that's what it is. So we'll find out what happens there at Empower Field at Mile High. Paul, it's a Jim Nantz, Tony Romo, Tracy Wolfson special on the NFL and CBS. It is Patrick Mahomes and York Kansas City Chiefs, along with Travis Kelce and potentially Taylor Swift yet again. They are home to take on Justin Herbert and the Chargers. And your Chiefs are a 5.5-point home favorite here.
Yeah. This game, the Chargers have not been playing great. They've been very up and down. I mean, they're at 2-3 this season. And coming into Arrowhead, they never do well in Arrowhead. The Chiefs are now 9-1 in the Patrick Mahomes era against the Chargers, 12-0 against the Broncos, or 7-2 actually against the Chargers. I want to say 9-1 against the Raiders, but they always end up playing the Chargers well. The Chargers have been able to kind of fight back. Out of all the teams in the AFC West, by far the Chargers have been able to play the Chiefs the best. But I think that this week, last week was a product of the short week, I think, and the Thursday night growing pains and all that kind of stuff with a low score, but they're starting to get things right. Mecole Hardman's back, which I think is going to be honestly a decent piece because Andy Reid knows how to use him. He was a dud with the Jets, but yeah, at the very least, they could use him in the punt returns. I loved being able to bring him back. Rashee Rice is starting to become a very good wide receiver. Travis Kelce, obviously. It's going to be due to step up, but Derwin James also plays him better than any other safety in football. He's notoriously been able to lock down Travis Kelce. So this could be a game where you see a big outcomes from Rashee Rice. Maybe you see a big outcome from Valdez Scandling. You could definitely, the wide receivers are going to get into the mix, but I'm definitely going to take the Chiefs here at home, -5.5 in Arrowhead. And I'm going to lock this one in as well. I think that this is going to be a definite that they're going to be able to win by this one. So I think they're going to come out hungry too. They're not happy with the way that they played on Thursday night, almost blowing a game to the Broncos. Their offense has been up and down over the past few weeks. You're bringing Mecole back, which is another familiar face. Maybe you're bringing Frank Clark back. I don't think even if they were to sign him, I don't think that he dresses heading into Sunday, but you might be bringing two pieces back over your last couple of Super Bowl teams. So I like that a lot, and I'm going to lock this one in. I think that the Chiefs are going to handle the Chargers, move to 6-1.
All right, Nick, what do you have here?
Yeah, I mean, Paul and I are kind of thinking on the same thought process here. I mean, the Chiefs have not clicked offensively. I've been saying this sounds like a broken record, but they have not clicked offensively so far this whole season. and people are going to say, well, Nick, you're being a little overdramatic. No, Patrick Mahomes has thrown some pretty lazy interceptions over the last three, four games, which they could have won by two or three touchdowns if he would stop three-quarter throwing balls and throwing them up there for easy interceptions, including in the Bronco game. I think he threw, what was it, one or two in the red zone, if I'm not mistaken. Also, he threw a pick, and that was horrible that they took points off the board. But the Chargers are just a dysfunctional mess in every way, shape, or form. Brandon Staley's got to go. They should have won that game against the Cowboys. They had every chance to win that game, and the defense just could not hold it back. They were letting CeeDee Lamb run routes all over the field. They were not stopping anything. But they had a drive at the end of that game to win. And, of course, Justin Herbert forces a throw as he's getting hit for a pick, and that, and all that goes out the window. Austin Eckler actually looked decent. Again, the Cowboys defense is a lot more fierce than some of the defenses they're going to play. The Chiefs are not the same defense that the Cowboys are. The Cowboys are a good defense, much better. So I think Eckler will have more opportunities to run the football in this game, but they're just so dysfunctional. They will find a way to throw the at least one or two picks, or they'll fumble football. I think the Chiefs are going to win this easily, and this will be a lock for me too.
All right, let's do a clean sweep then. This is also my lock of the week here. I love Kansas City laying the 5.5 here against the Chargers, guys. I think Paul said it, 9 days rest after winning last Thursday. The Chargers only have 5 days rest coming off that Monday night loss. And let me give you some fun numbers here. Andy Reid, 27-3 in his career when he has a 4+ day rest advantage over the opposition. Patrick Mahomes, 28-3 career in divisional games. And Justin Herbert's going to have to show me something for me to pick him again. Although I didn't pick him, I didn't pick him in the Monday night game last week. But it's such a wild card. Yeah, but see, that was such a weird game though. It was with the line and stuff, and maybe getting Dallas at a bad time. But
I thought, like Ben said last week, I thought that was going to be a trap game. But I don't know. The Chargers just wet the bed pretty much,
and they're still a tough team to figure out. They're always one of those tough teams to figure out. But
Staley's not going to have a job at the end of the year. We all know that for a fact.
Yeah, it's we're kind of sounding like a broken record on that. Again, he's had multiple instances this year where you question what he's doing. Some of them he's been able to get by with. Some of them he has not. But this is just a matchup of the better team with the better quarterback and the better coach. That's really nothing else needs to be added here. I'm going to take Kansas City. Now, I know that the last couple of meetings with these two teams have been close, and that's kind of maybe why the number is only at 5.5. I was actually a little surprised when I saw it, and then I looked at it, and I think the last like six meetings have been decided by like 6 points or so. I think that's the reason why. Let me just double check that. But nevertheless, I am going to take the Chiefs to win by at least 6 points here. And this, so for the three of us, this will be our bench lock here for Kansas City over the Chargers. The sixth meeting between Patrick Mahomes and Justin Herbert, all five previous meetings were decided by 6 points or fewer. Oh, so that's why the Chiefs are only laying 5.5. They think it could be another one of those. But, I mean, when the Chargers are coming off of a short week, traveling to Kansas City, which is a tough place to play, and Kansas City's had 9 days rest, and you're looking for them to really, like, take off. You know, they had the blowout win against the Bears, but I could almost see that being a big one here too. So, at least three locks. Actually, it's going to be four locks because Hank's also taken Kansas City -5.5, and he is as well putting this as his bench lock. And everybody else, though, will just take the Chiefs -5.5. So this will be a clean sweep across the board for Kansas City, and we've got four bench locks locked on it. And we'll see if we all can get all of us get on a winning way. You know, I've won two in a row in bench locks. This time, only locking a 5.5-point favorite.
By the way, what do you think the over/under is on this game? I'm looking at it.
I would say it's probably in the high 40s to 50.
Yeah. That you're pretty much spot on. It's 48.
Yeah. So something like 27-21 Kansas City then. Let's do that.
Well, I don't think you're going to see defense. I don't think you're going to see any defense in this game, really, to be honest. I think it's going to be who scores more. That's really what you're going to see more in this game.
And that's mostly been when the Chargers and the Chiefs have met over the past few years. The Chargers always play the Chiefs tight, and it's always a high-scoring game. But I feel like we've gotten the best out of the Chargers over the last couple of seasons in a couple of different appearances. They've given us the best and the best that they can possibly play. We're getting them at a really bad time now, which is why I think it's going to be probably the biggest blowout that we've seen. It's since Mahomes has taken over against the Chargers. Even though the Chargers do usually play us well, I think it's going to be different for that reason. And they're also just not playing great football either.
You know, the one thing I'll say, though, that's different this year with Kansas City, Paul, and I'll see if you agree with me on this, is this actually looks like one of their better defensive teams that they've had in quite some time. They, you know, they've won games this year, kind of low-scoring games, which is something they haven't done in years past. When they've had a close, low-scoring game, they've usually been on the wrong side of that. And this year they've had the win against Jacksonville, which was close and low-scoring, the win against the Jets, the win against Minnesota. So it's been kind of different, but they're still getting the job done.
Yeah, this has been – even though it's early in the season, this has been the best start to the season from the defense that we've seen in the entire Mahomes era with 100%. This has been his best defense he's been able to play alongside, because while the offense has not been able to get going so far, the defense has held them to 5-1, led them to 5-1. They've been keeping teams low. The secondary has been great. They haven't been committing penalties. And the defensive line has been awesome too. And Chris Jones coming up with big plays again, making more and more of a reason why he's got to get paid big time this offseason. Even if it's a big salary cap hit, he's just a playmaker, comes up with big plays in late minutes, all that kind of stuff. So, you're exactly right. This Chiefs defense is much different than we've seen from them since Alex Smith was there, and they used to have those tremendous defensive teams.
For sure. All right, Nick Morgasen, game of the week here on Sunday Night Football. It's Mike Tirico, Chris Collinsworth, and Melissa Stark on NBC. A battle of 5-1 teams here as Tua Tagovailoa's Miami Dolphins take on Jalen Hurts' Philadelphia Eagles. And in Philly, the Eagles are a 2.5-point favorite.
This is going to be probably right now the game of the year, in my opinion. I think these are both the most competitive offenses in the NFL right now. I looked at the over-under. The over-under is 52. That's a pretty high number. But I was telling Johnny, and I'll tell you, Paul, like that, I think Miami, like we talk about timing right now, Miami's timing is perfect. Yep. And the Eagles' timing right now could not be any worse the way that they're playing football. They lost a horrible game to the Jets at MetLife. Jalen Hurts throws three picks. They lose, Lane Johnson? Or down for an injury,
yeah.
Who is their major offensive lineman who really makes their games go and stay consistent. I think they had a few other injuries as well. Jalen Carter and Darius Slay were out last week. I don't know if they're back this week.
Yeah, those injuries broke before after we picked the game last week.
I still thought that the Eagles were going to find a way just because their offensive weapons. A.J. Brown, by the way, who's been a beast. If I'm not mistaken, didn't he have five straight games of 125 yards? That was a record?
Something like that, yeah.
Yeah.
So, he's not the issue. It's the offensive line, well, a little bit of the offensive line, but really the defense, that's not holding teams down like they were doing. And I think before the game also, they did not allow any points defensively on their side of the ball before that game, which is kind of insane thinking about. But I like the Dolphins here. I like the upset. I like Tua. I like the weapons. I like Tyreek. I like Jalen Waddle. I know they don't have Echan out for the injury. They don't have Jeff Wilson. He's out with an injury. I don't know who the running back is. Do you know who the running back is?
Raheem Mostert.
Oh, well, I like Mostert too. I think Mostert's been great. So I think it's going to be too many offensive weapons with Miami for the Eagles to handle. I just think, like you said, giant timing's everything. Upset special, Sunday Night Football, Dolphins plus 2.5.
Paul, I'm curious. Let me go to you. What do you think here?
I definitely completely agree. I like Dolphins at plus 2.5. This is going to be a really, really high-scoring game, I think. This is going to be two defenses that completely get manhandled. I love what the Dolphins have been able to do on offense to start the season. They are a scary offense with Tua, Waddle, and Tyreek, just the three of them alone being as dangerous as they are. And again, the Eagles' defense hasn't been as amazing as their offense has been. I mean, the Eagles' offense has been fantastic. That's why I think it's going to be a high-scoring game. It's going to be a close game, definitely, too, in Philly. But I like what the Dolphins have been doing right now. And honestly, like, the Dolphins, I think, are the biggest threat to the Chiefs right now in the AFC. That's the one team that, like, that I'd say that I'm truly scared of. There's really no one else in the AFC that really scares me in being able to knock off the Chiefs. I'm not that scared of the Bills. There's a variety of teams that I'm really not that scared of. The Dolphins, if they're fully healthy, their offense is scary and they could make some noise. So I think they're in, just like you were saying too, they're coming in at a perfect time too. They're on a roll. The Eagles are down right now. So I like the Dolphins a lot.
So we got the battle of former Alabama quarterbacks facing each other for the first
time in their
career, right? Tua and Jalen Hurts. Jalen Hurts was there, and then Tua came in the national championship game for him, and then Jalen ended up transferring. So this game would have been my second lock of the week. And the sexy pick here, of course, is to take the Dolphins. So that's why I'm taking the Eagles. And honestly, guys, I worry about Philly's pass defense, but they still boast a very strong defensive line that could slow down Tua and this video game offense like Buffalo did in week four. And I think that's a possibility here. And let's also remember one other thing, too. This game is going to be in Philadelphia, where it's going to be in the 40s at kickoff, not in Miami, where it'd be in the 80s. And I'd like to see what Tua does in cold weather. It's different than doing it down there in Miami, where he's been very, very comfortable in doing. I also think this is a line that's begging you to take Miami. So I'm going to take Philadelphia to keep it a kind of a lower scoring game, which I think would be more beneficial to them. And I think they find a way to bounce back here. I'm going to take the money, only ask them to win by a field goal here. I feel like this is a repeat of the Dolphins-Bills game from week four, when the Bills were a slight favorite. Everybody and the kid brother wanted to take the Dolphins, and they got a big offensive reality check. I almost can see that happening again here, but it might be a little bit of a closer game. The Bills are not going to put up – I mean, in this case, the Eagles are not going to put 48 points like the Bills did against the Dolphins. I think this is more like 27-20 Philadelphia. So I would take the under, and I would take the money with the Eagles on Sunday night. So let's see. Nick D also takes the Eagles. Ben takes the Eagles. Zan's taking the Eagles, but a non-cover. And Tom and Hank both are going to agree with you two in taking the Dolphins upset special against Philly.
Wait a minute. So Zan is saying that he thinks the Eagles are going to win, but they're only going to win by two?
One or two points. That's what he's doing.
Well, I'm just saying, because when you do against the spread, it's under when you take the number. So he's saying they have to win by two. That's what he's saying.
Yeah, he's not leaving himself a lot of wiggle room, that's for sure. But
in this game with these offensive weapons, I don't think this is a two-point game.
I don't think so either. I think I think it could be 3-7. I think it could be that close. But I feel like this is week four again.
I don't know. Well, you were comparing
this. It won't be a 48-20 final, though. That's the difference.
Right, but you were comparing this to Buffalo. Buffalo didn't have the injuries. Like, now we're talking about – well, Buffalo now has the injuries. And same thing with the Eagles. I'm telling you, the Lane Johnson injury is going to be huge.
Absolutely. I think it was hurting them last year. You know, Hank brought that up a lot on Game On and during our Football Fridays last season, the Lane Johnson injury, which really wasn't talked about. But I have a feeling that, you know, one of the things that Buffalo and Philly did have are still very, very good defenses. And maybe timing is that. If this game – now, let's say this game goes to Miami, maybe it's a different story.
I don't think the Eagles win in Miami, to be quite honest.
Yeah, and I don't think Buffalo wins in Miami. And if they play them later in the year, I think with all their defensive injuries, I think it's a little bit different going down to Miami. We saw that last season, that was one of the few losses that Buffalo had. But I think playing in a different environment where it's going to be very, very – you know, the city of Philadelphia right now is – I hate to say this as always a New Yorker, but the city of Philadelphia right now is on fire when it comes to sports, between the Phillies in the playoffs, between, you know, the 76ers who are still very good, between the Eagles, between the Flyers. I mean, they've got a bunch of good sports right now. I mean, the Flyers are not that good, but, you know, a lot of their teams are. So the momentum is on their side. And again, it's only going to be in the 40s at kickoff there. So it definitely different. And on Sunday Night Football, when a lot of the country will be watching it, I think it's a little bit of a different spot. But I'm excited for this one as well. I mean, I only get about 3 hours of sleep after watching this, but it's going to be worth it here on Sunday night. Paul, it's a Joe Buck, Troy Aikman, Lisa Salter special on Monday Night Football on ESPN as the San Francisco 49ers try and rebound off their first loss of the year as well. And they go to Minnesota to take on Kirk Cousins and the Minnesota Vikings. And the Niners are a 6.5-point favorite.
Yeah, this is going to be an interesting game. I'm going to take the Niners at -6.5. I think that their offense has just been so explosive this year. I mean, the big question, though, is going to be around McCaffrey and around Deebo Samuel, like if the two of them are going to play. The line definitely may change drastically if we end up hearing, that the two of them can't play or something. I think that it becomes a much closer game, but assuming that the two of them are able to suit up, I think the 49ers would be able to take care of this. The Vikings have not been good this season. They've been a little bit better the last couple of games, but, Kirk Cousins' crew has not been able to figure it out. Justin Jefferson also out the next several weeks, which is a huge loss, on their offense. But Kirk Cousins has still been able to put up pretty solid numbers, regardless, but, they as a team just haven't been as great, but it is in Minnesota. And if you take away Deebo and take away McCaffrey, it's becomes a completely different game. But as of right now, as of Thursday, I'm going with the 49ers at -6.5.
What do you have here, Nick?
I think Paul is pretty much spot on. There's some factors in this game that you really need to take into account. Like you said, McCaffrey, if he's healthy, when you saw after he went out, the 49ers offense was dysfunctional without McCaffrey in there. Like, they look lost without him being in there as a threat, because they were able to take those two or three guys that they were putting on McCaffrey and spread it out over between the wide receivers and whatever other running back they had in. Like, it was a whole different offense. And like we said, Cleveland is no slouch in defense, so I understand why the game was close. They shouldn't have lost. They shouldn't have missed the field goal at the end of the game. That looked embarrassing. But it also matters if Debo's back, too, because Deebo actually makes that offense run. People think, like, he's a nobody. Like, they use those end-arounds with Deebo that really opens up the offensive line. But, again, with the Vikings, Justin Jefferson is out. He could be done for the season, depending on what they find out. And if he's done for the season, their season's completely over, because they don't have anybody to be a number one. They're pretty much going to rely on Alexander Mattison to run the football, basically, for the whole season. And that's not winning football. Considering you have a Kirk Cousins who's a throwing quarterback, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 plans ahead of every other running play. So, like Paul said, if McCaffrey is there and if Deebo is there, which it sounds like, even though they're questionable, they are going to play. That's what the reports say. Yeah. Then you have to take the Niners. You have to take the Niners. You have no choice, really, in this regard, because Justin Jefferson being out is going to ruin the offense. So take the Niners -6.5.
Yeah, let's talk about Minnesota's side. I know we're focused on the 49ers here for a second, but look at Minnesota's game last week. Even though they beat the Bears, guys, they only managed 220 total yards against that shoddy defense and converted just 2 of 13 third down attempts. And now you've got this 49ers defense rolling into town after their first loss of the year. Yeah, and I love the fact this number came down under 7. I mean, if I knew that, I probably would actually put a bench lock on this game as well. But here's also another fun fact. Well, there's a couple of fun facts, you know. The Vikings have not won a game at U.S. Bank Stadium since Christmas Eve.
Wow.
So we are approaching 10 months since the last time the Vikings won a home game. And if you have any other, you know, if you're still hesitating, you know, do I take the Niners? Do I take the Vikings? Let's do this, all right? Look at my list here. and let's pull out the Kirk Cousins checklist.
Oh, no.
All right. Yeah. So is this game in prime time? Sure is. This game a national TV game? It sure is. Does Kirk Cousins not have his number one wide receiver? He does not. Does Kirk Cousins have Marcus Davenport on defense? No. Give you more specific numbers here. 11-18 career in prime time, 2-10 on Monday Night Football. Make it 11-19. Make it 2-11 on Monday night. Give me the Niners minus the 6.5 against the Vikings in Minnesota, guys.
Yeah, like I said, like this was on my list of locks when I was looking at the game. It was either going to be the Chiefs or it was either going to be the Niners. I think the only thing that scared me away from the Niners was the possible injuries to McCaffrey and Debo. Otherwise, I probably would have taken the Niners, knowing that Jefferson was out of this game.
Yeah, if everyone was fully healthy, I would have taken this as my lock over the Chiefs Chargers game. I think if there was no question marks.
Yeah. By the way, Tom will put a bench lock on this game, taking the Niners, and everybody else is also taking San Fran minus 6.5. So this will be a clean sweep to wrap up Week 7 of Football Friday. Nick?
Oh, yeah. I totally forgot because I got so entrenched in the football picks. So I wish we had some more people here to share this with. But basically what I'll say is we have a new partnership starting in Week 8. We had a company reach out to us. It's our first sponsor for the Empty the Bench Podcast Network. The name of the app is called Wolf Spread. It is a gambling app where basically it's kind of like the beginner learnings of gambling. You play in friend groups. And actually, I think I have it because he sent me the actual stuff. If I can go to it quickly, if I can find it on my phone. And basically, the best way to describe it is it's a sports betting competition completely free on the Wolf Spread app. Here's how it basically works. Everybody gets 2,000 fantasy dollars, which is fake money, to bet on the NFL games. Whoever can profit the most with their 2,000 bankroll wins. And basically, you get into groups of 9 or 10. And it's a friendly competition. But it has the same gambling perspectives of the spread and the over-under. And it has all that stuff. But you're not betting real money, so you don't feel like you're losing your house every week. So we're happy to have the partnership with Wolf Spread. They will be the first thing they're working on with us is Football Friday. And the plan is to expand to other shows, all our other sports shows as well. So thank you, Wolf Spread, for coming on and partnering with us.
Absolutely. And next week will be a great week for them to debut with us because everybody is playing in Week 8 next week. So we'll have a full slate of games to preview, predict, and break down for you, including the big Super Bowl coming up in Week 8 between the Jets and the Giants, which I know, Nick, you guys are going to do a live stream on that next Sunday as well. So next week's a big week, you know, not only for the football side, but really from the sports side in general, because now all four major sports will be in the course of the conversation. That's why definitely check out Paul and the 3&D next week as the season is just a few short days away. You know, hockey's here. Obviously, we know the NFL here almost 2 weeks in. In fact, I was looking at the math here. We are now one-third of the way through our picks for the season. We came into this week with 93 picks, which is now one-third of the way through. So that is officially where we are at. And, of course, college football still going strong and baseball in the postseason. And the LCS is heading closer to the World Series and crowning a champion there. So definitely a lot of fun times. And, of course, folks, we want to hear from you as well. So first and foremost, you can check us out on our YouTube channel, youtube.com/ETB Network, where if you like our Football Fridays and all of our content, leave us a like. If you're new, hit that subscribe button. And, of course, make sure your notifications are all set so you know when all of our stuff's going to be coming out. You can check us out on etbpodcast.com, where you can get our picks in written form. You can also get fantasy angles from Dan, who does some great stuff, and so much more. And you can also, if you can't watch us, check us out on audio platforms. If you're on the go, wherever you get your favorite podcasts, we are there for you as well. So another big week coming up next week for us. Guys, have a great weekend. It's good seeing you all.
Yeah, great to see everybody, and looking forward to this new partnership we're going to have.
Absolutely. Of course, we'll have more information about that next week. Paul, good luck to your Chiefs, because I'm not going to say good luck to the Giants because they're 1-5. Paul, good luck to your Chiefs, and Nick's team's on a bye week. So we
yes, I can't lose.
Sit back, relax, and enjoy, Nick. That's what I would say for you.
Yeah, you're right.
So that's what we're going to go with. So going to be a great weekend of football, both collegiate and pro. And then, of course, all four pro sports will be in action starting next week. So for Paul Lombardi, Nick Morgasen, and everybody, Tom Albano, Hank Indictor, Nick DiMartino, Ben Kruse, and Zain Bando, I'm Johnny Montalbano. Everybody have a great weekend. I'll catch you all again next week. And then for week 8 of Football Friday with Wolfgang next week.
Wolf spread.
Thank you. I'm thinking of Wolfgang Puck. See you next week, everybody.
We're not a fancy restaurant. Okay. We'll see you next week.